Today in America, roughly 12,000 babies will be born. Most will grow up with a full shot at the American dream. But on any given day across our nation, 2,500 children experience severe neglect or abuse. Nearly a million a year.
My dad was an alcoholic, and so he was abusive from time to time.
I can remember being tied up as a little girl, sitting in a chair, hands tied up, legs tied up.
You knew you don't get him angry because you know what'll happen.
My mother looked at me and she slapped me. I never forget that. And at that time, she told me to leave.
Four children die every day as a result of abuse in America. Of those who survive, many are permanently damaged. But what of those who go beyond survival to lead productive lives? How do they do it? And what can they teach us in the fight against child abuse?
I know from growing up that it's very difficult. And you know, I know that a great education is one way, is a very important key to success.
I went for something that society would have told me you can't do. That's what I did. I'm saying, oh yes, I can.
This is the story of two young adults from very different worlds who traveled the road beyond abuse.
The Road Beyond Abuse is brought to you by the Mary Hall Singleton Fund and by supporters of Georgia Public Broadcasting. Thank you.
Janetta McSwain lives in Atlanta with her sons Jaleel and Rashad. Her childhood was spent in Birmingham, Alabama, where she and her sister Sonia were abused by three uncles while in the care of their grandmother.
Moving from Birmingham, Alabama, and going back home over the years has been an eye-opener, has showed me this is what you left. Why didn't you leave earlier? Passing my old neighborhood, I began to realize what I had left. I began to see the destruction. My grandmother would go fishing a lot. She loved to go fishing, and she would leave me and my sister, who was six. I was five, and I had a boy cousin who was five. The abuse started with my uncles sitting us in chairs, maybe three chairs in the living room. They would lock all the doors.
Whoop us, beat us, make us get them blowjobs. Whoop us with stitching cords. We used to try to run outside. They still beat us. And they,
I can remember my panties as a little girl being ripped off and your clothes ripped off. It was just so brutal. And I couldn't understand why would somebody in your blood, your relatives, do that to you. And having a boy cousin, watching a boy, you know, being molested and penetrated, it was just horrific. It was horrific to go through. And this happened for years.
Janetta contracted syphilis as a result of the sexual abuse. She began to urinate in the bed and was punished for that.
One of my punishments was to sit outside. Had to be about December, January. To sit outside butt naked, no clothes, right out the bed, until I learned my lesson.
While sitting on these steps in raw Birmingham winters, Janetta came down with pneumonia and was hospitalized. Threatened by her uncles, she never told about the abuse.
I was so afraid, so I didn't tell anyone because the fear that was put in me. Another thing was my mother was gone so much, and coming from a parent who didn't want me, who also emotionally abused me, why should I tell? Who cared? You know, who cared?
Why was they beating us? Why? Why was nobody there but us to protect us? Why was they beating our heads into the doors? Why was they grabbing our feet from behind us? Why? Why did nobody believe us? Why? What was my mama? What was my mama?
Jeanette Madison is the mother of Janetta and Sonia. She was sexually abused by her father as a child.
That was me and my sister Gertrude, and we slept in the same bed. And I can remember, you know, I always wanted to sleep over by the window because the bed was pushed up to the wall by the window. I wanted to sleep by the window, so crawling hands that night, you know, couldn't find me.
In response to her home life, Jeanette Madison took to the streets of Birmingham. She soon had two young daughters that she didn't want.
I was young, didn't have no education, and pregnant on the streets because I never stayed at home. The only time I went home was to take a bath and change clothes and hit the streets.
The abuse from my mother, I think, was the worst. I wish I never had you. I wish I'd have left you in the bushes. I wish I'd flushed you down the commode.
I did say things to them that I regret. And I do know that it hurt them in the long run. It hurt them because I made them feel like they wouldn't want it.
When my mother would come home, it was like the most fearful thing that you better go in the other room. She may throw dishes, she may break dishes. She was a very, very bitter woman.
By the time Janetta and Sonia were 9 and 10 years old, their mother was a chronic drinker who entertained men in her home.
She would get drunk and let them come to our house and let them spend the night with us while she drunk in her room. They'll come in our room and do what they want to do while she laying in her bed with another man.
We knew they were coming in to get us, so we would lay in the bed together because we knew the door was going to open and we knew one of us was going to get taken out of the room. And one night, my uncle came in and she begged him to take her instead of me.
Michael McLean lives at the Omega House, an independent living facility for young men in Augusta, Georgia.
I got kitchen tonight, and Eric's got the floors in the living room and the dining room. We go out, get jobs, have to save up money. We cook, clean, house chores, you know, just taking care of yourself and learning how to live on your own.
Okay. Get a broom, sweep that porch all them set.
Stanley Moffat is the director and the authority at Omega House.
When they come here, they have such a negative attitude of no self-esteem, no self-worth at all. Michael has one of the worst cases you'd ever hear of about abuse and as far as it goes.
At age 20, Michael has no photographs or mementos from his childhood, but he has his memories of a long-lost sister, a drug-addicted mother, and an alcoholic father.
Me and him just really didn't get along. He was abusive to my mom, and that was really one thing that really separated me and him. It was a real big rift between us because of that.
Jeff Handley is one of the many social service caseworkers who've dealt over the years with Michael's family.
Their father was a very controlling individual. He was always there. He was always with the children. He was always with his wife. They were never alone to go anywhere to do anything or other than when they were at school, the two children were at school. He was a very controlling individual.
You don't tell Michael what he can do, what he can't do.
He's my mom.
My father and my mother got into a real big argument one night, and he was violent with my mother, and it woke me up. So I went over there, and I had tried to jump on him because I was very protective of my mother. And he slung me across the room, and then he walked out.
From age 6 to 12, life was chaotic for Michael and his sister, Laura.
We moved out from living with him, and we lived with my mother in Atlanta, and we got kicked out of the house that we were living in. So we had lived in homeless shelters for a while.
They moved constantly until drugs finally caught up with their mother.
She got really, really heavy into drug usage, and she had overdosed on cocaine and had a drug-induced stroke.
His mother right now is just on her deathbed. She has AIDS and cancer and you name it, she's got it.
My aunt and grandmother that live out in Oklahoma came out and got her and took her back out to Oklahoma, and she's been living there ever since.
Michael last saw his mother when he was 12 years old.
Not having my mom with me was really devastating because I was very close to her and she was always there for me, so I had that connection with her.
Michael and his sister were returned to their father. He lived in a rural area south of Dublin, Georgia, with his new wife.
At that time, me and my father had a very tumultuous relationship. We were constantly fighting, arguing. We had gotten into several physical altercations. My stepmom and him would get into it every now and again over us kids because he'd be too harsh on us or she'd be too harsh on us and the other one wouldn't like it, so they'd get into it and then I'd have to break up those fights.
By the time they were teenagers, Janetta and Sonia were in trouble.
I start hanging in the streets, start meeting the wrong kind of men. I dropped out of high school in 11th grade. I stopped caring about going to school. My mother dropped out. Everybody in my family dropped out, so it was a cycle.
Everybody in my family been to jail, on drugs, didn't finish school. So what I got to live for? What I got to amount to? Nothing. What I got to accomplish? Nothing.
And at that point in my life, it wasn't a problem doing anything I had to do. It wasn't a problem. I had already been violated and raped. So I didn't have any essence about myself. Didn't know how to be a lady. Wasn't taught how to be a lady.
I had a crack baby. I was in denial. I didn't want the baby. I didn't want to tell nobody.
And I met the first person that came along. I got pregnant the first two or three times we were together. And he left, said it wasn't his baby. Bam, I'm a single mother now.
Repeating their mother's pattern, both sisters had unwanted children by their late teens. But there was one difference between Janetta and Sonia.
Never done drugs. But I have done everything other than drugs, but that was one of my rock bottoms that I wasn't going to do.
I did everything for crack. People don't want to tell people their story when they got on drugs. I did everything it was to get drugs. I robbed, I stole, I prostituted, honey. I was down to 98 pounds. I had no breasts. I had no behind. You can see my ribs. I was jumping in the cars. I had guns put to my head. I had knives put to me. I slept in abandoned houses. I slept in abandoned cars. I was eating sometimes, maybe once a week.
It was so traumatic for me. We were 11 months apart. It's to see her. I think that was the hardest part of my life. It's to see her throw her life away.
In 2002, Nancy Handley, a caseworker for the Lawrence County Department of Family and Children's Services, was assigned to investigate allegations of child abuse by Michael's father, Stephen McLean.
There were issues about his drinking and the discipline and the behaviors that occurred during his drinking. Yelling, wanting to physically discipline the children, things of that nature.
I was afraid of him because as a child, I've seen the brute strength that he has when he's angry. And I knew that if it came down to it, one of the two of us would get hurt very badly, and I didn't want that to happen.
Handley's investigation revealed a socially isolated family under the ironclad control of the father. Her first impression of Michael was that he was developmentally delayed.
He wouldn't talk, and his mannerisms and the fact that, you know, his behavior was so immature. You would ask him something often, he would look down, you know, when before he would answer, he would look at his father. And then, you know, when he talked to you, oftentimes he would look down instead of looking at you.
Away from home, Michael could be a very different person.
A teacher's dream, a student that was like a sponge that would absorb everything.
Gene Gaylord, his auto mechanics teacher at West Lawrence High School, remembers Michael as an avid student.
Grade-wise, he had the highest grade in the class. Of course, we have, you know, students of all levels mixed together and everything. So, but he did have the best grade in the class.
I just enjoy school. I just really loved the classroom settings. I just enjoyed going to school a lot.
Students are, they're some of the best actors that we have. They can set those things aside at home and they can come to school, and from a teacher standpoint, you would never recognize that there was anything that was going on.
Back at home, Michael's father underwent counseling and appeared to improve. DFACS, the Department of Family and Children's Services, closed the case. But 2 years later, he would be charged with sexually abusing his own daughter.
We had an outcry from Michael McLean's sister, Laura, that she had been molested by her father. Our department asked for custody of Laura, and she was placed in the temporary custody of the Department of Family and Children's Services.
In 2004, Michael was brought before Lawrence County Juvenile Court Judge Bill Tribble. Along with his father, Michael was charged with sexually abusing his sister, Laura.
I was brought before sheriff because my father was sexually molesting my younger sister. And the charges were also brought up on me for molesting my sister.
Here he is, stand up here and wants to plead guilty or admit delinquency to whatever crime he was charged with, sexual crime he was charged with.
Honestly, I hadn't done it, but it was the thing that, you know, I was afraid of my dad at the time. You know, he was there. It's just that overwhelming, you know, just a presence of him being there. So I had made the confession.
He had abused his sister, but he'd been abused too. He just thought that's what happens in families.
In spite of his belief that Michael had sexually abused his sister, Judge Tribble made a momentous decision in Michael's life.
If you look at the file, I never signed the adjudication. I just held the file and got DFACS involved because although this child was a perpetrator, sexual perpetrator, he was also a very deprived child. He had been exposed to all this sexual activity and drugs and alcohol, and it had affected him.
Because of Judge Tribble's actions, Michael was not sent into the criminal justice system.
obviously, at Judge Treble's, after whatever his decision was, the charges were dropped and they were taken off my record.
Hey, this is Judge Bill Treble from Dublin. Can I speak to the director?
Judge Treble ordered treatment rather than punishment for Michael. He also ordered that Michael be removed from his father's home and sent to a place called Broken Shackle Ranch.
It's a really nice place. They do a good job.
As Michael entered foster care, his father was on the run from the law.
When we got to the 72-hour hearing, Michael's dad had left the scene. He had fled. We couldn't find him. He couldn't be located by law enforcement. They were looking for him.
Over the next few years, Janetta worked small jobs and had a second son named Jaleel. There were men in her life, but the relationships didn't last.
There have been times is that you go there, you have flashbacks, you know? Somebody ripping something off of you, and do you know how ugly and nasty and degraded that makes you feel? It's not a pretty picture, you know? And it's not fair to the person who loves you and the person who's reaching out to you.
In her mid-20s, Janetta confronted her mother about the years of abuse.
I gave her detail after detail. She couldn't sit there and listen. No, I'm your mother. You can't talk to me this way. You're not going to talk to me this way. And she would leave. And this happened for years.
I didn't know these things was going on. They never showed no signs that they were being abused. They never came to me and said anything. They never acted any kind of way strange.
She was in denial of everything. Why? A parent supposed to be a parent. A mother supposed to be there for her child, to protect her child. Mama was in so much denial because she wasn't a parent to be there to protect us. And it hurt her. And it hurt her so bad, she wasn't there to protect us.
While Sonia remained stuck in anger, Janetta moved on. After months of studying, she took the GED test.
But I missed it by one point. And thank God I went back the next day, the next week, and retook it. And I was the only one there out of 30 students. I was the only one to show back that day. And I think even then, a part of my life is that I wanted something.
By the time she turned 30, Janetta had an awakening.
I looked at my boys and I said, are there going to be rapists? Are they going to molest their kids? Because at that time, I realized every man in my family that I knew had touched me inappropriately. So I knew then that this is a cycle. And I said to myself, I'm gonna break this cycle. Didn't know at that time, never heard about a cycle. Just knew that I was in one. Knew that I didn't want to continue to be like my mother. And knew that I didn't want my two male boys to grow up and be a statistic. They want them to be in jail. They want them on the corner selling dope. They want them to get caught up and somebody offer them dope and say, hey, you know, sell this and bring me your money. I didn't want that. I didn't want them to be looked down upon. I didn't want them to be ashamed of me. I owed them something else.
Janetta decided to leave Birmingham. She told her sons they were moving to Atlanta.
My 12-year-old said to me, I'm ready to go. And he was 12. And I feel so bad because he had to grow up. At 12, he had to take on so much responsibility because I had a 5-year-old.
Even at a young age, Rashad understood the legacy of abuse in his family.
I looked at these families who, like, everyone's died in the family or they've been robbers and killers and rapers, and it goes on from generation to generation and never stops, keep going. And that's how my family was looking. Especially with the males in our family. So I figured right then and there, I think I was in probably middle school, probably going to high school. I just figured right then, right there, that I would guess I'll burn the weight and I had to stop it because I didn't want to see my brother like that. And I didn't want to end up like that myself, but worse, I didn't want to see my brother like that.
Mm-hmm. In April 2004, Michael was sent to Broken Shackle Ranch, a foster care facility in Davisboro, Georgia. Not quite 16, he had lost his home, his school, and everything he knew.
When I had first gotten to Broken Shackle Ranch, I really did not want to be there. I was in fights all the time. I got into fights 2 to 3 times a week at least.
Gary Cobb is the founder of Broken Shackle Ranch.
He was angry. You get taken away from your home, you're angry. I don't care how bad of a home it is, you're still angry. The worst home is better than anywhere else to these kids most of the time. And that was Michael's idea of it.
I was, you know, really unruly. I didn't follow the rules. I had cussed out a couple of the staff there. Just really didn't want to be there, didn't care about being there.
What you got going on?
Michael refused to work the program, which included vocational training and study toward a GED.
We were the enemy, you know. We were the people that he was fighting the most, you know, the authority.
Soon after his arrival at Broken Shackle Ranch, Michael received devastating news.
I was getting ready to eat dinner, and the director of the program came over and said that he needed to speak with me about something in his office. So I went over there, we sat down, and he said that sometime over the past week that my dad had shot and killed my stepmother.
We got the message that his father had killed his stepmother. And then we got the message that his father may be coming here to get him too, because he was angry at everybody.
The ranch went into security lockdown in case Michael's father showed up with the intent to kill his son.
Sometime within a week after that, I had heard from the staff there that my father had shot and killed himself. And after that, it really hit me, and I realized, okay, he really did do it.
David Cobb is the director of Broken Shackle Ranch.
It was on the back porch of the main house when we told him that his dad had killed himself. And Michael's response was just very quiet, you know, like he, you know, he didn't know it was coming, of course, but just like he just no reaction much at all to begin with.
All of a sudden, you don't have anybody left. You're not sure where your mother is, your biological mother, and that your father has committed suicide and that your stepmother is deceased. And here you are, you know, in a group home somewhere. I cannot imagine how that would feel.
After that, I had very serious bouts of depression. And in November of that year, I had attempted to slit my wrists. I didn't care. I didn't have a home to go to. I didn't have nobody to talk to. I didn't care.
With no contacts and little money, Janetta and her two sons moved to Atlanta.
I didn't have a job. I didn't have anything, but I know one thing. I was leaving somewhere, and I was coming somewhere better. And I said to myself, I get a chance to be anybody I want to be. You know, who knows me?
Armed with her GED, Janetta was accepted at Kennesaw State University, northwest of Atlanta.
I went to Kennesaw, and I walked into missions, and I can never forget the feeling. The feeling of a new day. Oh, my goodness. I'm going to learn something.
Jan Phillips was Janetta's academic advisor and counselor.
Okay. All right. And you said you were with Janetta going back to take the GED, she was saying, I'm taking control of my life. I'm getting my education back. You know, this was stolen from me in childhood. I couldn't focus on that at that time. But now I have an opportunity to go back and get back what was taken away from me.
You've done a lot of work in your coursework, and you're on real good terms as far as the progress.
There was the concern, would I be able to do this? And what she needed was the encouragement.
I I was afraid. Oh my God, I'm 32 years old. I don't know anything.
Is it a lot of jobs in that field?
And she was very open and candid about what type of help she needed. And then I was more than happy to encourage her and say, you know, maybe you need to take this course because this may be a little easier on you right now. But at the same time, yes, you have the ability to be able to go and to do well.
I didn't really know how to write. I didn't know how to write a paragraph. I didn't know how to use a subject and a verb. Simple 8 parts of speech. I didn't know.
Professor Leonard Witt was Janetta's writing teacher.
Frankly, her writing wasn't very good. I still even remember kind of mentioning to my wife, you know, that I got a student in here, I'm not quite sure what to do. She's enthusiastic, she wants to work hard. But, you know, her writing needs some work.
The subjects would be in the
key. Went to the smartest people in my classroom and said, can you help me? I need help. And I studied and I worked hard and I went to school 16 to 18 hours a semester.
In her particular case, she went to the writing center. We have a writing center here. She got a little help from that. I tried to give her as much help as I could. And incrementally, the writing started getting better and better.
I gave up everything. I gave up dating. I gave up going out. I gave up friends. I gave up my life. And I dedicated it to school because I wanted to get that degree. I wanted my mother to see what I had achieved. I wanted my boys to see that this is obtainable.
I'm on my way to the writing lab. Yeah.
For the next year, Michael received counseling every day at Broken Shackle Ranch. He was also sent to a psychiatrist in Augusta.
I really couldn't talk with them about it because they didn't know me and they didn't know what I was going through. So it really didn't help too much.
I read it in the local newspaper. I couldn't even imagine what he was actually going through.
Upon learning about the tragedy in Michael's life, Gene Gaylord resolved to contact his former student.
It was something that I felt like that God just laid on my heart to follow through and to follow up on this.
In the midst of a busy life as teacher and family man, Gene Gaylord drove over 50 miles each way to visit Michael at Broken Shackle Ranch.
There was a time that I tried to visit him at least once a week and then probably more often on from a standpoint that I went maybe on a bi-weekly basis. Every 2 weeks I'd maybe go over on Sunday afternoon.
His decision to, you know, find out where I was at, what I was doing, how I was doing, had another profound effect on my life, knowing that there are people out there, other than my immediate family that I had no contact with, that there were people out there who cared for me and people who were, you know, interested in me and my situation, wanted to help me.
It's not sometimes what you say, and because sometimes we don't know exactly what to say. It's just the fact of being there.
So that really gave me the motivation to start working the program and start change my attitude and start working the program, trying to move up through the level system so I could, you know, work up to a high enough level to where I could go off campus and just go out and hang out with them for the day. And that's really what pushed me to do so well.
The staff at Broken Shackle Ranch also worked with Michael. Over time, his attitude changed.
He got progressively, you know, better at not acting out, dealing with his anger through our anger management classes and just his counselors and just people just really reassuring him, not throwing him away when he would have a cussing fit, you know.
Within 6 months, Michael had passed his GED with flying colors.
Back before I had been put in DFACS, I had, you know, the thought that, okay, I know everything. I know what's best for me. But now I've been through the system and went to Broken Shackle, and I've had a different sort of family experience there and learned that, you know, it was nothing like well, I had any thoughts of what a family could be like. It was so much more helpful there.
While at Broken Shackle Ranch, Michael was able to contact his sister, Laura, who was living with their mother in Oklahoma.
The one thing that really stood out that was really unusual to me is that she had apologized for putting me through what she had. And I was like, you know, it's not your fault. It wasn't your fault. You know, what happened was what happened. And we just really just made up after that, and we had a very, very good relationship after that.
While Janetta was finding her way in Atlanta, Sonia was still lost in Birmingham.
I was stuck in time. I wasn't growing a knife. I was always being angry. I was trying to kill myself so much. I was giving up.
There were times, in order for me to see my sister, I would have to armor myself. Because I would have to go down alleys, dope houses, anywhere to find her.
When I got on drugs, my sister told me, when you get ready to clean your act up, really clean your act up, I got a house and you got a room. You can come stay with me. But you got to be ready to clean your act up.
There were times I found my sister under houses. There were times I found her in dope houses where she wouldn't even come to the door. I knew she was in there. There were times I had to leave notes and I had to say, just tell her I love her. Just tell her I love her.
At Kennesaw State, Janetta shared her story with a few close friends. But the word got out.
I dropped out of high school at 17.
And I end up finding myself just talking people, and I got letters that people start writing me. When I start meeting these women coming to me, I don't love myself. I don't love me. I'm nobody. And I'm looking at them saying, now, you surely could love you if I love me. And then I realized what love was. I realized that I love myself. And I realized other people saw it.
I believe that what Janetta gained from her experience at Kennesaw State University was she built self-respect. She began to realize that she had a lot of gifts in a lot of different areas.
In just 3 years, Janetta graduated with a degree in communications from Kennesaw State University.
The value of education for Janetta is a life change, not only socioeconomically, but emotionally. Because what it does is it lifts, or it has lifted her up out of where she was before. And she saw that as a way to put the past behind her so she could build a better future and a much more comfortable life.
That was one of the greatest experiences in my life, was Kennesaw State.
When Michael turned 18, he had a big decision to make between what seemed like freedom or the promise of a college education.
To me, going to college is very important because I know the value that a good education has and that you really need to have a good education to make it anywhere in the world today.
Michael chose to stay in foster care and was sent to the Omega House in Augusta.
The reason I decided to stay in DFACS after my 18th birthday was simply because of the fact of DFACS pays for college, tuition, books, and all that stuff up to a bachelor's degree. That's really the main reason that I decided to sign myself back in, because I knew I wouldn't be able to afford college otherwise.
Michael enrolled at Georgia Military College in Augusta, where he is studying to be a nurse.
Originally, I had chosen nursing mainly because my mother and stepmother were certified nursing assistants. But I like working with people, you know, just being there and helping people. So I figured, you know, well, nursing's a really good area to do that in.
You guys are going to be nursing students. You have to get used to smells. I already warned you about that. You have to be used to the smell of organ failure, the smell of gangrene, the smell of ketosis, the smell of death.
Biologist Randy Elvidge is Michael's primary professor at Georgia Military College.
What you got?
I don't know if it's still in there or not.
He's going to ask questions. He volunteers answers. He's very smart.
Oh, sure. Yep.
He took the final exam, and I think he missed one question on the entire final. And that's for a whole quarter's worth of work.
Now you can see all the paramylin.
It's very important for him to get the most out of everything. He's not happy with just spitting back facts.
He wants you to get into the sciences. He wants you to learn the material, not just memorize it for a test. And that's really what drew me into his classes so much, and that's the reason why I enjoyed him so much and took all of my sciences with him.
Working at Sam's Club, Michael saved his money for a year to go on a biology trip to the Bahamas.
So we had a two-week stay down in San Salvador, Bahamas for our lab. And for a lot of us, it was our first time out of country, and for several of us, it was our first time on an airplane.
I'm sure people that experience abuse, many of them find shelter in very, very narrow areas. And he doesn't lock himself in a comfort zone. He opens himself up. And I think that has helped him a lot.
You know what? Education is contagious. Boy, I can walk in the room and I can sit with the best of the best.
On fire with the love of education, Janetta decided to pursue a master in social work at Clark Atlanta University. That's where she met Professor Susan Kozak.
Hey, Dr. Kozak. When I first saw Dr. Kozak in orientation, she's white and I'm black. And I said, what? Now what? How is she going to teach me anything about where I come from?
Then Janetta came up to me a couple of days later and said, I'd like to know. I want to get to know you. And little by little, I had her in class for three classes.
And she said, I want you to write something. And I said, write what? And at that time, I didn't want to write again. I didn't want to write.
We're going to meet tomorrow and talk about...
Susan Kozak wanted Janetta to write her life story, including how she was able to transcend the childhood abuse.
Okay, I'm going to do the PowerPoint.
Over the course of our relationship, I've been talking to her about how did she get out? How did she get to where she is at? And she didn't know. And we kept talking and talking and talking. And I said, you need to write these down. She wrote them down in 12 steps.
To change 40 years.
I realized I don't have a substance abuse, but I have an addiction. And my addiction was the streets. And I thought, wow. So in about an hour, I wrote these 12 steps. Got up in the middle of the night, went to my computer, and just started typing. And the first step was becoming self-aware that you're in a cycle. You're in a cycle.
Under the guidance of Susan Kozak, Janetta created a 12-step program for victims of abuse.
And my story is intertwined with the 12 steps. In other words, how did I get step one? How did I break the cycle? Then I talk about a little bit about that. Step two, how did I get here? And one of my cycles is becoming self-aware. It's a self-aware. You don't have to be poor. You don't have to live in poverty. You don't have to accept what people say you gotta be.
There's just something about Janetta that attracts people. She is genuine, she's got the most incredible energy, and she's real. I mean, she is real in that she'll tell you like it is, but yet she's very kind and very empowering, and very forgiving.
A big part of the 12-step program involves forgiveness. For Janetta and Sonia, that meant their mother, whose neglect had allowed the abuse to take place.
I can just look at her and get mad. I can just look at her and get angry. We're working with forgiveness, a lot of forgiveness, a lot of emotions, a lot of pain, a lot of hurt.
Attempting to face their past, Janetta and Sonia returned to the home, now abandoned, where they had once been abused.
If a person stays in that place where they don't want to forgive, they will be blinded to the reality that they have a way out, they can forgive. They get angry, they get abusive, they turn right around and do the very same thing that they hated because it was done to them. And then the cycle repeats itself.
The breakthrough for Janetta came when her mother admitted her own childhood experience of sexual abuse.
And then I knew that my mother couldn't love me because she couldn't love herself. She'd been all these years fighting with this old ugly secret of hers. She couldn't love me. She couldn't, you cannot love, you can't give what you don't have. So I forgave my mother a little bit more easily than my sister did. But I have to be honest with you. It wasn't easy forgiving. It's not easy.
So I wanted to forgive her. I said, Mama, God is telling me it's over. The war is over. It's a new beginning.
And my daughters have taught me how to love, to respect, to hold on to my beliefs that things can be better. I thank God for Sonya and Janetta. Because when I look at them, I see me.
And what of the three uncles who violently abused Janetta and Sonya?
My three uncles that molested me, one is in prison. He's been in prison all his life. One dropped dead of a heart attack a few years ago. One was got shot, got killed.
Most of the males in our family is either in prison or dead. And I knew I wasn't going to be either or wanted to be either. I had to do something, and I knew the military and going to college would be that because I knew I'm going to make it.
A high school graduate, Janetta's son Rashad has decided to enter the Air Force as a way to further his education.
I'm probably the only male in my family graduating from high school. So, yeah, I knew college was for me.
On July 1st, 2008, Rashad McSwain entered the military at Fort Gillem near Atlanta. His mother was there for him.
He's the first black male in my family to, you know, to do something so honorable in his life, to something so recognized, and I'm just so proud of him, you know.
Michael is really, really close to getting ready to get out, be on his own. He's not far from being on his own. He likes, I'd say, another year of school. Maybe two. It depends on what he wants to do.
Because of his good grades, Michael has qualified for several college scholarships.
He knows he's smart, and he knows he can use that to get him where he wants to be in life, and that's a good thing.
Since coming to the Omega House, Michael has had time to reflect on his past.
It hurts to think that I actually went through it and know that that's my past. But then again, on the flip side of it, I know I've been through it, and it's only made me that much stronger and that much more determined.
In recent years, Michael has lost contact with his sister, Laura.
I currently don't know where my sister is at. After an altercation between her and my mom, she moved back to Georgia, and that's the last I know of. I haven't heard from her since before she had left.
Michael may have lost his original family, but he hopes to create a new one.
Right now, I'm currently engaged to who I think is the most wonderful woman ever. We are currently both enrolled in college. Once we both have our careers somewhat basically established, possibly plan on starting a family.
I think he'll be an excellent father. I think he'll be an excellent father.
I plan on, you know, being there for my children and, you know, showing them, you know, the love and, you know, nurturing that a father needs to do that will really just have that positive effect on their lives that I really never had.
The Georgia Department of Human Resources spends millions of dollars a year to help young adults like Michael.
I can't even tell you the amount of money for what one child, what is spent. But I do believe that it's worth it because I think this has made all the difference in the world in Michael's life.
These children are worth saving. Every child has value, and we can help a lot of them. We just got to get our emphasis on being compassionate and helpful. In Michael's case, it worked real well because of everybody working together, all the players coming together. And boy, I hope, and I feel like he's going to make it.
In the summer of 2008, Janetta graduated from Clark Atlanta University with a master's degree in social work.
But now, I feel like a complete woman. Utterly, I feel beautiful, I feel fantastic, I feel whole, 100% complete. You know why? I no longer have to do anything that demeans me. I can hold my head up. I can ask for respect. Not only do I ask for it, I will not tolerate being demeaned. I will not tolerate being pushed around. I will not tolerate being mistreated by anyone.
Her spirit was never destroyed. They destroyed her body, they took away her childhood, but they never took away her spirit, which is really quite amazing.
It did not surprise me when Janetta got her degree in social work, because her passion after her healing came was that she wanted to do that for other people.
Breaking the cycle, beating the odds, and I am Janetta McSwain.
Janetta has decided that part of her work will be to share her story with others.
And my mission is to empower women from every background, culture, race. I don't care who you are. This is not a story for just the poor and just the addictive behaviors and the substance abuse. This is for anybody.
In the end, what made the difference for Janetta and Michael?
People like Janetta who are resilient are not afraid of the truth. That's the bottom line. Janetta could admit what happened to her, and she said, well, yes, this happened. I accept the fact that this happened, but I don't have to let it affect me the rest of my life.
Bottom line, Michael, I think, was receptive to making a difference in his life, and I think that helps when you have that individual who wants to do better, who wants to make an improvement in their life.
People who have made it have had someone somewhere along the line believe in them. And unfortunately, there are people out there who have never had anybody to believe in them. And Sonia didn't have anybody.
Sonia has been diagnosed with HIV, but with Janetta's support, she has a new attitude about life.
Had some rough days and relapsed a couple times and suicide spirit a couple times. But you know what? I'm blessed. My sister back in my life. I got married and I got a little house now. But I'm blessed. I'm blessed.
Janetta and Michael each had the desire and the will to pursue a better life. But where would Janetta be without the encouragement from her professors at Kennesaw State University? Or the guidance of her mentor, Susan Kosak, at Clark Atlanta University?
Before I got to Clark, I began to pray. And I said, send me somebody in my life that just absolutely loves me, that just care about me.
Would Michael have survived without the intervention of Judge Bill Tribble?
If we hadn't taken him out of the home, the abuse would have continued, and he could have been dead like other family members were dead.
I believe that Judge Tribble saved the boy's life. And I've always believed that.
And who would Michael be today if he had never met his auto mechanics teacher, Jean Gaylord?
That really had a profound effect, that someone out there was, you know, somebody out there cared and was trying to get in touch and trying to find out how I was doing.
As the sun rises on another day in America, 12,000 more children will be born. How well they do in life depends not only on their parents, but on all of us.
The Road Beyond Abuse is brought to you by the Mary Hall Singleton Fund and by supporters of Georgia Public Broadcasting. Thank you.
This has been a production of Georgia Public Broadcasting.